The missing plane. What happened? It's a gigantic Rorschach test for the entire planet. Okay? My answer is it doesn't matter. That's my answer to it. What matters is the vision of oneness. Nothing else has any value. We have to turn all our valuing towards the vision of oneness. That is what matters, okay? And this is 100% true. Our personality, what we call our personality, is actually a device, a conglomeration of tactics and defenses and dynamics, personality dynamics, as it were, that is actually designed to remind us of what? It's to remind us of something. What is it reminding us of? Its actually aim is to remind us of nothingness, nothing, meaninglessness, annihilation, eternal death. It's actually a way to remind us of eternal death. Because that's the identity that the ego tells us is our identity. Because the ego wants us dead, eternally dead, actually. And so this personality body complex, with its vulnerability, its aging, and ultimate death, and the confusion and chaos and lack of unity in the personality, is literally a device that we're using to remember our identity, according to the ego. On the other hand, the vision of oneness is also a device designed to help us remember our true identity, all right, which is the oneness, the one identity. So all we have to do is exchange the personality for the vision of oneness. That's the exchange that takes place. That's the exchange that takes place. If we look at it this way, we see it in a totally different new light. And we can allow the personality. The personality doesn't matter anymore. It's just a device. There is no self there. See, this is something we need to learn. We've heard various teachers say there is no I. Where's the I? Well, there is no self to the personality. There is no I. There is no identity there. It's a device to help us remember an identity. See, we're in a condition where we've forgotten our identity. And the ego says, go this direction. This is where you'll find your identity. And the Holy Spirit says, go this direction. This is where you'll find your identity. Different directions, mutually exclusive directions. You cannot say that two different, completely different directions are compatible just because they share the term direction, right? That's not compatible. Only magical thinking would say that that's compatible. So there are two different directions, two different reminding devices. The personality is one, the vision of oneness is the other. And so don't think you're supposed to do both. Because the vision of oneness doesn't remind us of the personality at all. It doesn't remind us of eternal death at all. It reminds us of eternal life and the one identity, which is totally all-inclusive, effortlessly present. Effortlessly present. Whereas the personality is reminding us of what? Total annihilation, meaninglessness, eternal death. That's what it's trying to remind us of. Of course, we have a problem with that because we say, you know, I can't quite remember that. So we are fundamentally have to turn away from the personality, exchange it for the vision of oneness. Both are devices, reminding devices. That's the only, they share that in common, that they're both devices that remind us, but what they remind us of is completely mutually exclusive. Meaning denies non-meaning. Non-meaning denies meaning. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. Perfect inclusivity denies exclusivity, and exclusivity denies perfect inclusivity. Perfect effortlessness denies effort, and effort denies perfect effortlessness. They can't both be true. If the nature of reality is this perfectly effortless, totally all-inclusive, all-pervasive, everywhere-ness. Obviously, that precludes some other reality, which is not everywhere, which is not all-inclusive, which is not effortless, which et cetera, right? Can't both be true. Truth and its opposite cannot both be true. Truth and its opposite cannot both be true. It's not possible. The ego tells us that there is a way to make this all compatible. Okay, and we're like spellbound because we think when we get this answer, we'll be greater than God. Okay? So we are still trusting the ego because we think the ego has this answer for us, because it seems like it does. It's very confident. The ego is very confident it has this answer for us. And so I say, okay, I just gotta do what the ego wants me to do. The ego tells me to do this, I do this. Whatever the ego wants, as soon as I finally get that answer, then I will be all happy, all powerful, and no more problems. Well, the confidence the ego has that has the answer for you is how to combine mutual exclusives. Is what is the ego's answer? The ego's answer is that is your eternal death, so that it doesn't have to tell you anything. See, that's why it's confident. It's not that it has the answer. It doesn't have any answer. It believes that the one who wants the answer, but gets rid of that, doesn't have to give any answer at all, and will stop being bugged. You know, stop. The demand will stop on the ego. The ego wants that demand to stop. And so the ego seems very interested to stop that demand. We go to the ego and say, hey, ego, we got this demand. We want the answer. And the ego says, yeah, I really want to give you the answer too. All right, so you need to really go in this direction and you're going to get it. So the ego seems very eager to end this pressure on it. It is eager. But the only way to end this pressure for the ego is to get rid of its maker, to annihilate spirit. And that's its plan. That's its goal, actually. So the more you see this, the more the vision of oneness seems to be much more valuable. Say, hey, I think I like this vision of oneness. It's sounding better all the time, isn't it? So there is a point to looking into the madness of this world, and mad it is indeed. It's because their valuing then starts to turn more and more to the vision of oneness. Says, wow, this isn't just some pie-in-the-sky mystical, you know, elective course that I can, you know, maybe dabble in or something. And no. You realize, holy cow, I really have to get this. This is all important, because the alternative is absolutely terrible. Absolutely terrible. And we'll just keep it simple here. Just keep it simple. The more you see this root dynamic of the ego and its confidence that it can give you the answer you want, the secret answer that'll enable you to solve your continuity problem by making mutual exclusives compatible and won't have to deal with any compatibility issue, continuity issue. The more we look into this and see where its confidence is coming from, because it is planning your annihilation, and it thinks it has a way. And having already experienced it myself, it's the complete fullness of this ego's plan. I know it's total chaos. Mental chaos is plan. And when you try to integrate all the so-called personality device it has, all this conflicting projection and device, it leads itself to total mental chaos. And then the ego thinks this will drive spirit to commit suicide. But spirit cannot commit suicide. Spirit can kill the body. I was in a restaurant last night, and the person sitting right across from me had this hat on, said suicidal tendencies, and it was completely tattooed, you know, just massive tattoo, suicidal tendencies. Yeah, that's the world for sure. That's the ego. The ego wants to drive spirit into such despair that it commits suicide. And I've been there. I know exactly what this is like. And you feel this just endless despair. But you realize you can't end it. There is no suicide that can end this despair. There isn't anything. And you just say, wow, this is horrible. What do I do? That's where the Holy Spirit comes in. And you ask for help. And you gradually get clued in to this whole situation. And all we're doing here, we're looking at various aspects of this overall dreadful non-deal that we're engaged in, this futility that we're engaged in, really. If we haven't been engaged in the futility, believe me, we would all have the vision of oneness by now. So I know what the ego's plan for everyone is and how it ends up. Total mental chaos. And then the despair, the depression, the pressure on you to commit spiritual suicide. And I know the vision of oneness is there because I've seen it. I've experienced it. So I know the two dichotomies, and I know which one is true and which one's false. And so then I'm able to, you know, just look at it and share it and bring it to light so you can start looking at it. Because it's all about your valuing the vision of oneness instead of trying to make mutual exclusives compatible. Which is the ego tells you there's a way. And why do we buy into the ego telling this? Because of the continuity problem. That's all there is. Continuity problem is solved through familiarity with spiritual teaching, spiritual exercises, and ultimately leading to the vision of oneness. That's how it's solved. So you have to listen to high spiritual discourse. You have to do right spiritual exercises and practices. There's no escaping that. And you just have to keep doing it every day and build up familiarity and comfort. And eventually you'll be able to look at the ego and all our attempts to get the secret answer without actually, you know, without the vision of oneness, without God helping us, without actually, you know, because of the fear of the continuity problem is so severe that we keep buying into the ego's mumbo jumbo magical thinking of, oh, this'll work, oh, this'll work, this'll work. But all of it, actually, the ego wants to annihilate us. And it can't actually annihilate us. Okay, here's the thing. The ego is just a projection of our own will. It cannot annihilate us. In fact, we cannot be annihilated at all. But the ego believes its only hope is to get us, spirit, to annihilate ourselves. And to that aim, it puts us under this incredible suffering, that this mental chaos. And I've been through that 100%. It is just terrible beyond any description. And that's its plan. And it tries to find a way to get spirit to destroy itself. Spirit can't destroy itself. That's the problem we have, you see. So the sooner we accept this, that spirit cannot destroy itself, the sooner we will start tackling the continuity problem. There is no other way. You have to tackle the continuity problem with the help of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit saves you time. You may think it's going to take you a million years. No. Now, this morning my phone wasn't working so well. It was blank, and I couldn't get it to work, so I took out the battery, and I restarted the phone. Cell phone, and the display screen came on, and it has a, you know, date at the bottom of the display screen, displays the date. Today is the what is today, the 14th, 3/14/2/14, right? Well, the date on my phone that it displayed, get this, and I noticed, I said, whoa, what's this, this is a cell phone, okay, folks. The date displayed 12/31/1969. That is what it displayed for me. 12/31/1969. Right before the 70s began, right? How many years has it been in the 70s? Since the beginning of the 70s? 44 years, hasn't it? 44 years. Very symbolic. I get out into my vehicle, I look at the trip counter, 44.4. 44.4. April will be 44.4, you would think, depending on how you count. But the 70s, it was one decade, the 80s, two decades, 90s, three decades, 2000s, four decades, and then 2001, two, three, four. Okay, so you could say it's been 44 years since then. And coming up April, 4 months, or January, February, March, the fourth month will be April. And 44 is the number of death. It's a very bad number, actually. It also was a fact that is when I slipped into trying to use the personality primarily to remind myself of identity instead of the vision of oneness. I was born with the vision of oneness. Many children, you know, have the sense of oneness, and they gradually, the personality forms, they take on that personality, all this personality stuff, and then that reminds them of something completely opposite. And my struggle to then try to integrate them, the personality says you got to integrate, you need to integrate the oneness and personality, you know, integrating mutual exclusives, began then. So I would have been 12 years old at that time, 12 and a half or something. That's when I actually fell into delusion, 44 years ago. And my cell phone shows me the date, 1969. That's when everything has gone bad. It's been 44.4 years since everything went bad in this world, to tell you the truth. The influx of severe trouble into this world began 1970. That's what I've said, as when it began. So we're up close now to 44.4 years. Well, it wouldn't be technically 0.4, 4 months decimally. We might even be at decimal 0.4. No, 0.4 is close to half a year. So anyway, 44 and 4 months, you can look at it that way. Close to that, getting close to that. This is symbolically the number of death. I've got the 44th president who first took elective office in the Senate at the age of 44. Okay, 44th president. Amazing 44, fours lining up again. This is very significant. This is the number of personality. And again, personality is an attempt to convince us that our identity is death-based. Okay? The personality is an attempt to convince us that our identity is death-based, and the only way to reach our identity is to die a spiritual death. And that we're told that once we die this spiritual death, we're resurrected, we'll be resurrected as new life. That's the ego story. That's the ego story. Is that through death, life will emerge, new life will emerge. That's a lie. The ego tells us that so that it can try to bring about a spiritual death in us, so that we're gone forever. And the ego doesn't have to worry about explaining how to combine mutual exclusives, because it's impossible. The ego has this burden of trying to accomplish the impossible off its head. You know, the ego is so pressed and, you know, for demanding, come on, I want you to be a good guy, make us happy. And the ego just, you know, says, the only way I can be happy is to get rid of your demands, get rid of you. That's really what's going on. And this is the price we're paying for trying to be greater than God and uncreate creation or be prior to God. This is the price we pay. There's this dreadful dynamic of being told that our salvation comes from spiritual death, and that magically out of a total spiritual death will arise a new life. The ego is just making that up. Okay, that's just something that we hear that and we say, oh, good, so we're on the right track here. This personality, spiritual death we're headed towards, that's going to actually save us or become a new new being. Not true. That's not true. That is not the rebirth, the second birth, being born again. Being born again means accepting the vision of oneness. That is what is being born again. Because our identity right now, being born again means having a new identity, different identity. Our identity now is based on this device. Our direction towards an identity is the personality. What we do is we exchange that for the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness is now the device we use to remember our true identity, which is simply this effortless presence. Without a second effortless presence. This effortless, fresh presence that we cannot pin down through words or definitions. But we will be reminded of that. We realize, that is my true identity. This other death-based path I was on is completely bogus. Completely bogus. Now, of course, all this information runs against the program of the world, which all the stuff we have been doing for so long. Of course, we've been mistaken is all. And all you do with mistakes is just, oh, okay, I made a mistake. I see why I made the mistake. I was trying to be greater than God, which is impossible. And I was trying to believe it's possible to uncreate what I am, because when we uncreate creation, we're uncreating ourselves. So our real goal was to try and annihilate ourselves, thinking that then somehow we could be reborn and be greater than ourselves, greater than reality. And we projected a will to do this that seemed to be coming from someplace other than ourselves, so we could believe that this whole thing was somehow forced upon us and we have no choice but to do it. Otherwise, we would see through it and just say, this is ridiculous, and stop it. But because we have projected our will and we think that there's some demand, authoritative demand by something that has a more powerful will than us, telling us that this is what we must do and this is right and just and etc., we feel we got no choice but to follow its mandates and dictates, and we're just trying to figure out a way how to successfully follow its mandates. This is projected, our own projected will. The ego is our own projected will. There is no will over us. Our will and the will of all of reality is one will. One will. One totally, just one. Just one. Not even unified, because it's beyond unified. Unified has to do with, like, we think of parts, like this part and this part and this part. No, it is just one totally non-exclusive, effortless being, everywhereness, zero dimensionality, as it were, totally without any crystallized attributes whatsoever. Okay, so this is our true identity, and we need to be reminded of it because of the continuity issue. And the ego doesn't want us to see the vision, buying the vision of oneness. It doesn't want. It knows. It says, "Hey, if you do that." It says you're going to die. No, if you do that, the ego's plan will die. Well, our plan of being prime greater will die. It will realize that don't want it anymore. Don't want it anymore. So, just looking at all this stuff is super helpful. Super helpful. It's also tiring. I'm feeling very, very tired these days. I can't really do much of anything. The strain is so severe. Because this stuff is core stuff that the whole world has been engaged in, this massive self-deceit. It has. Massive self-deceit. Thinking, believing there's some way to get saved other than accepting the Holy Spirit's remedy, which is the vision of oneness. We've been trying to find some other way, some substitute for that. Fall right into the trap of the ego. Try to please the ego through rituals, beliefs, teachings, etc. Having faith that when we die, we're saved. If we just follow the ego, then once we die, we'll be saved, that kind of thing. No, the Holy Spirit doesn't ask us to die. The Holy Spirit says, right now, here, now, the vision of oneness is present for you, and it's yours to keep, and just make this exchange of devices, that's all. Don't have to die at all. Dying has no role in it whatsoever, none. Sacrifice has no role in it whatsoever. You're setting down the personality, and the personality is just this grab bag of all these bizarre, magical belief, crazy dynamics that are telling us we should do this, we should do this, we should be that, we should be this, this, or that, and it's just a grab bag. Put this bag down of jumbled junk and exchange it for the pure, pristine, immaculate, totally cohesive, effortless, 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 effortless. Exchange it for that. That's all. That's it. That's the whole thing. So when I bring up any issues about the world, I'm only bringing them up to look at them. Say, look at this. Just look at it. Just look at it. Just see what you can see. That's all I've done my whole life, is just look at this world and say, what's going on here? Just look at it. Just notice it. Say, huh? Yeah. Okay. Why is that? And it's just like, there's all these taboos in the world that you don't dare draw this conclusion. Well, if a conclusion is taboo, then you're looking, you'll find you're looking to feel like you can't do it. You're up against some block, some wall. It's a taboo. You can't look there. And you'll look somewhere else. So, of course, the ego is going to make those areas that are very central to its self-delusion, the self-delusion, make them taboo. Of course it will. And say, you can't look there. And I always say, wait a minute, why can't we look there? What are you talking about? I'm suspicious when the ego says you can't look there. I say, hey, I wonder why the ego doesn't want us to look there. So it's a matter of simply having honest appraisal of the situation in this world. And just saying, you know what, it doesn't add up. This world doesn't, what's going on here doesn't add up at all. There's something really screwy about this world. And there is, totally. It's more than we realize. But reduced to its essence, it becomes very simple. And that is, the ego wants to get rid of us. And all the help it's giving is helping us, it's trying to help us get rid of ourselves. That's really what's going on here. The ego can't get rid of us, but it thinks we can get rid of ourselves. So it's trying to convince us to get rid of ourselves. And of course, if we thought we had to keep reincarnating in all these bodies over and over, we would think, wow, yeah, I really want to get rid of myself because I don't want to keep doing this. So you reach a point where the personality, you follow the path for so long that the personality begins to implode and you go into this total chaos and you get the full measure of what the ego really wants for you, which is what I experienced to the fullest extent. It wants to get rid of us. It says, look, just kill yourself. That's what it told me. Ego told me, just kill yourself. I mean, kill the spirit. That's what it boiled down to. It tried to lower, make me feel so insignificant and nothing that I would decide, you know what, I just need to kill myself. That's what the ego trip is. That's what its aim is, 100%. And so in knowing that, then I'm able to trace back all these taboos that the ego has said, don't look here, don't look there, and realize that the ego has the whole world in its grasp, and we're blindly following its advice, because we are too scared of the continuity issue. No matter how smart we are, there's nothing that succeeds like familiarity. Smartness cannot banish a familiarity problem. It cannot. And this is the bitter pill that all smart people have to swallow, which I had to swallow. It's like, oh, you know, it doesn't matter if you're the smartest person ever lived. If you have a continuity problem, a familiarity problem, you know, your smartness won't fix it. Will not get rid of it for you. You can punch all the numbers you want to in the computer. It won't get rid of it for you. Total futile. It's futility that way. You literally have to begin taking steps, short steps, step, 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 step. And that is listening, hearing, contemplating, high spiritual discourse, true truth, clarity, and right spiritual practices. There's no other remedy for anybody. So those people who think they're going to shirk it, they're smart enough. The ego tells everyone, hey, you don't have to do that. You're smart enough. You're doing good, pleasing me. I won't make you do that. That's what the ego tells you. Don't worry. Just do what I tell you and follow along the advice and teachings I give you, and you'll never have to suffer for having to work hard like they're working. You won't have to do that. You'll be able to bypass all that. So people, of course, oh, great, great ego. Thank you very much. It's a total lie. Total lie. That's why I remember Jesus always telling me, he said, go faster, faster, more and more practice, more and more practice, full out. That's all you got to do. Just do that. Nothing else. He says, just, hey, don't slack. I mean, this is basically what Jesus and my teachers have told me, is don't be a slacker on the spiritual path. That's the sum total of their advice. Don't be a slacker, because that'll never work for you. And what's the advice of the ego? Be a slacker. It's that simple. And so which one are you gonna, you can't do both, right? You can't really do both. Today's a great, another impossibly beautiful California day. In driving this morning, it was like almost like an epiphany, because it is still not even spring here, March 14th. And yet it's been so such a warm winter that everything is just bursting out. It's like full on spring, okay. And yet there's still some trees that are still in winter mode. They haven't yet, they're barely, you know, budding, because that's their cycle. They're late butter. So you have some aspects of winter. You have this full on, incredible, glistening spring happening, blooming flowers, everything. And then the sky and the atmosphere is summer. It's like August. And just driving, it's like the weird, it's like this total juxtaposition. It's amazing juxtaposition. And it's just, it's like you're saying like, wow, I've never experienced this before. This is a totally different feeling. I've never experienced it before, this juxtaposition of seasons like this. The sky was it's an August day in late winter with an early spring. And so it's like, wow, you know, what a juxtaposition. Now, the vision of oneness is also a great juxtaposition. It's because there's all this personality constructs that we have used, bodies, for instance, which are, bodies are supposed to remind us of our identity, which is supposed to be death, right? The ego says our identity is death. So of course we have these bodies that age. They're reminding us of death. What else can they possibly be? Come on, let's be honest about it here. And no matter what the ego says, its explanations are rubbish. So in the vision of oneness, there's still all things, all bodies, everything. But there's this effortless inclusivity in what is also always effortless inclusivity. So you got this, all these death devices effortlessly included in effortlessness that never diminishes in the slightest bit. So it's really this like complete juxtaposition that is so amazing. So there's this unexpected juxtaposition as I was driving today reminded me of the vision of oneness. Like, holy cow, it's something that we don't expect to see. I never expected to see this type of day, this situation, never. I said, wait a minute, is it summer, is it spring, is it winter? I don't know, what is this? And of course, because this is the world, nature also, the whole purpose of nature is to, again, remind us of our identity of death, because everything dies, everything comes to an end. Everything is very problematical. So as you're looking at this beautiful day, I was looking at all the dirt yesterday, and all the dirt is turning into summer-like dirt conditions, starting to crust up, shrink and crust up, right? The moisture is being sucked right out of it, and we don't have hardly any moisture in the ground at all here. So like the dirt conditions are like, well, this looks like summer. So it's like, what is going on? It's like, wow. So we have a terrible drought situation in California. So sure, there's this great weather, but in this nature, people think that nature is all in harmony. And there's all this wonder. No, it's not. If nature is all in harmony, why would we be having this horrific drought here? Why would we be having incredible blistering heat waves and droughts and, you know, massive areas turn into deserts? And nature is not some beautiful mother in perfect balance. It's a raging maniac, actually. It is really a raging maniac of all sorts of conflicting trends smashing into each other. Nature is always smashing into it. It's a churning sea. Nature is a churning sea. And all this talk, of poetic talk of trying to say how beautiful, wonderful nature is again, just worship, is idolatry, worshiping the ego, worshiping death, actually. You go up into the Northwest and all the forests that are dead because of the, you know, the beetles and the fungus or something that they bring into the trees and That's all harmony or something? No, it's not harmony. It's destruction. Nature is super destructive. What about all the extinction level events we've had in history? Super destructive. Nature is self-destructive, actually. And what self-destructivity is supposed to remind us of? Hello, 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 hello. The ego wants us to destroy ourselves. So as we're in this world, viewing nature, viewing bodies, we're seeing self-destruction. The principle, the idea, the notion of self-destruction. Why? To remind us of our identity, which is what? The ego wants us what? To destroy ourselves. And the ego says, once we destroy ourselves, we'll discover our true identity. It's funny, but it's literally what the ego believes. This is literally what's taking place. So, but we need to laugh at it because it's so, you know, it is, you see it clearly, it is funny. It's because it's simply, oh, okay, that's completely ridiculous. It is completely ridiculous because we wouldn't be here. You know, of course the ego tells us we'll be resurrected. Once we die, a spiritual death will be resurrected. What else can it say? That if it didn't say that, then we would just dismiss the ego just automatically. Say, you're completely insane. What are you talking about? We wouldn't be able to experience any happiness or any identity if we were completely eternally dead. If you're eternally dead, how can we experience identity? How can that be identity? That's completely absurd. The ego says, well, once you suffer this eternal death, then you're going to be reborn as a new, you know, new creature, new the prime creator. No. And you can realize now why the ego in the guise of God wrote me a Dear John letter and said, I'm through with you, man. I'm out of here. Because I'm onto the ego. I'm onto it. And it says, I got to clear out now. I got to clear out. Can't stay here anymore. And of course, it's not the ego's fault, because the ego's just our own projection.
So we really need to laugh at ourselves.
And how we thought we could pull this off, you know, this great heist that we could make this heist of reality and become prime creator, that all we have to do is annihilate ourselves, and then we would somehow be reborn as prime creator. What else can we do? What else could we imagine? Of course. But we cannot annihilate ourselves, because it's not the will of God that we have the will to do this. Because we are reality. Reality is not parts that can separate from one another. Reality is an indivisible whole. An indivisible whole. And so we have all this nature and all these people in the vision of oneness that don't remind us of anything except the one shared identity. Whereas before, all they reminded us of was eternal death. Now that everything's reminding us of eternal life. That's quite a juxtaposition. Yeah. All these forms, that this whole mechanism of trying to convince us that we need to destroy ourselves, is now convincing us that we cannot be destroyed. That's the greatness of it. Absolutely. So just like resting in these insights is great, but the insights kind of, you know, they dwindle off. And it's the vision of oneness we actually need. Certainly, purging the whole system from secrecy, taboo, and actually looking at everything clears the way, clears the blocks out. So that's all we're doing. That's all we're doing. We're just looking at it, just taking a look at it. Nobody has to say, oh yeah, this is true, or this is right. We just look at it and say, interesting, yeah. And just in the mood of repentance, just see what arises, what clarity arises. No need to argue, discuss, anything. We're just looking together, we're just looking at this. Does it fit? Does it fit? Of course it fits. But you can ask, does it fit? I say it definitely fits, but we have to look at it first and just kind of, it's not familiar, right? So we say, well, there's something that isn't right. It's the lack of familiarity. It's the continuity issue. Always account for the continuity problem first. in any effort you're making, what role is the continuity fear playing? And you're going to get off track for sure. Because the resistance you may feel is like you say, I feel all this resistance. Well, it can't, then you say, and the ego tells you, well, it can't be right then. Because the ego says, well, if it was right, you wouldn't feel any resistance to it. If it was true, you'd embrace it right away. No, you wouldn't. Because of the continuity problem. So ego's lying to you again. That's all it does is lie. And so you have to account for the continuity problem in your resistance towards any truth, which I certainly have experienced. Reading the high spiritual teachings, I realized, wow. I said, this is true. I know it's true, but then I'm resistant to it. And then I try to draw a conclusion that it's not true. I said, whoa, wait a minute. What is this? It's the continuity problem. Account for the continuity problem first. This is the essence of what I'm sharing. As far as pragmatism, remember, help is pragmatic. So you'll never be able to get to these insights until you account for the continuity problem. See, the only problem I really have is the continuity problem. Account for that. Practice that. I don't have an understanding problem. I have a continuity problem. It's very important. Because you can understand something, but your continuity fear will then tell you that this isn't for you, and therefore you conclude this isn't right. Something doesn't feel right, so it must be wrong. And then you'll conclude, well, it's not true. And then you'll go look somewhere else, and you've been thrown off track, just like that. So at any practice session you're doing, you have to start out, to be successful, to this mood of repentance, which says, I have a severe continuity problem, it's the only problem I really have, and we're accounting for that, primarily this, we must account for it in this practice. It must be accounted for. And in that mood, then you'll listen in a different way, and you won't bail out if you don't immediately embrace something you hear. You'll say, that sounds like it could very well be true, but because of my continuity problem, I know that I need to give it time, let me get familiar with it. Let me make sure that the continuity problem is not interfering with this. And you give it time. You don't become reactive to it. It's all important. It's all important. So we ask, how can we make faster progress? It is that you need to do all your practice in the mood of repentance, which is humble, serious, sober, non-argumentative, non-disputive, non-emotive. Not wanting to go somewhere real fast or anything, just hanging out and say, I'm going to just give this some time, I'm going to be patient. I know Jesus often said, when you do these exercises, do them with patience. Be patient. There's a mood of repentance. It's this spiritual patience. Just be patient with this. And that's necessary because you're thinking, the ego says, where are the immediate results? Where are the immediate results? They're not there because of the continuity problem. It's interfering. Absolutely. And Jesus also said, the path will take you a while. It'll take a while. For sure, you got to be patient. Why? Because of the continuity fear. No other reason. Continuity fear. Otherwise, we can unravel this thing easily. I mean, the problem I had when I came into the world is I felt like it should be easy for everybody. I didn't account for the continuity problem properly. That is for sure. And so I just ran into this trouble. Like, how come people can't just accept what I'm telling them? It's easy. It's just simple. Just reason it out. Boom, 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 boom. Done. Continuity problem. You need an incredible amount of patience to help out here. I remember Sri Ananda, my ma, is like, had perfect patience. Unbelievably patient. This is the essence of patience. Never seemed to be impatient at all in any situation. That's what's needed in this world is super patience, because the continuity problem, you'll be telling somebody and you think they get it, and the next moment they suddenly say, no, you're lying to me, you're trying to deceive me, oh, I'm scared, I need to leave, or because they didn't account for the continuity problem properly. So what I'm suggesting as the foundation for new practice, it's a universal foundation actually, is we must address the continuity problem. We must confess the continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. Now, for instance, in the Christian Catholic Mass, they do start out that way. Is that I'm a sinner, but they it's been transposed into a personality issue. But it's not a personality issue. You say, well, I've done this to somebody else. I lied. I cheated. I looked at someone with lust. I could have helped someone else better. My personality has failings. With basically, my personality is coming up short. It's not succeeding. Of course. So somehow it's gotten transposed into the egoic personality situation over a lot of long amount of time. Even though the root of truth, the form is still there, the structure a little bit, but it's been, the emphasis has been shifted. But what we need to start out, any practice is, I have a severe continuity problem. Not just a little, an extremely severe continuity problem. And I know that is going to interfere with my acceptance of truth simply because it's unfamiliar to me, not because it's untrue. So in my practicing over my entire lifetime, starting in severe earnest in 1970, I would say, up to that point, I was still trying to hold things together. And then from that point, I realized I had, I couldn't hold together because I couldn't account for the continuity problem. I didn't see it properly. And that led to disaster because I kept trying to willfully push truth on people and explain it and say, what's the matter? How come you can't get it? Now, it doesn't work that way. And I came across A Course in Miracles in 1978, and that saved me because Jesus basically pointed out what the trouble, really essentially saying we have a severe continuity problem. You got to acquaint yourself with, reorient your valuing towards a vision of oneness and get used to that. Because we've been doing everything wrong for so long, we simply are so used to it, we can't just dispose of it instantly. We feel lack of continuity, breaking continuity, like an abyss. We feel like this an abyss. I think Lan Chenpa said that the main problem in this world is people think that accepting truth would throw them into a complete abyss. What he's really saying, if I can translate this, is they fear a continuity problem. They feel that a break in continuity is somehow a break in identity, and a break in identity would be this abyss that they'd fall into. So it's the same problem that's been around that spiritual teachers have, commented on and saying, wow, there is this incredible, it's simply a continuity problem. That's all it is. Truth is easy. Anyone can see through it. It is the fear of this abyss, an identity abyss, that we're so scared of. So the continuity problem and the vision of oneness go together, because the vision of oneness is really the true remedy for the continuity problem. But we want to have a soft landing into that. Now, some people take a rather more abrupt landing into the vision of oneness. That is possible. It is possible to have the vision of oneness like that, because the vision of oneness itself is a soft landing. It is a soft landing. So it's possible that you can accept that right now. It is possible. But most people won't do it that way. The vast majority will take a slower path and make a soft landing into the vision of oneness through right spiritual practice. And again, no matter how smart you are, the issue, continuity issue, remains just as it is. Your smartness doesn't dissipate it. Now, I thought if I could just talk to smart people, I could explain to them, they could get it intellectually, that should be enough. It's not enough. Doesn't really help. You have to go at the situation through patience, through the mood of repentance, which is a patient mood, is really realizing, I probably won't succeed right now. I have a severe continuity problem. It's definitely getting in the way. And I'm going to acknowledge that at the very beginning of practice. It's all important, in my opinion. If you really want to succeed, if you really pragmatically want to succeed, then there are certain fundamental steps, conditions you have to employ if you really want to have a successful completion into the vision of oneness. And this humility, humbleness, I have a severe continuity problem, I'm serious, I realize that I have to really get familiar with this material, so I'm really going to practice. All of that is included in what is necessary. It absolutely is. So, you know, question is, are you going to be a slacker or not a slacker? I remember when I first started out, I had this dream, and this voice in the dream spoke to me. I went into a classroom, and there's this book, this new curriculum, and there were students in there, and I felt like I needed to study it. And then I ended up leaving the classroom, and there was this intense rain taking place, just beating me down. It was incredible. And this voice came out of the rain and says, why are you leaving the classroom? Do you feel it's too difficult for you? Is that why you're leaving? I said, no, I can get it. It's not that tough. I know I can get it. And then I said, why are you leaving? And I didn't have an answer. I said, And the voice said, is it because you're lazy? In other words, are you because you're choosing to be a slacker? That's it. The Holy Spirit hit it on the nail on the head. And I realized the only reason I was leaving because I was lazy. I have a continuity problem. And I felt it's too much work to deal with that. You know, so the Holy Spirit said, you either choose the path of being a slacker or not a slacker. It's the only choice that we really have in life here in this world. It's the only choice we have. Am I going to be a slacker or not a slacker? And every day of my life, that's the same choice. Today, again, this incredible cobalt summer and winter and spring day. And it's just like, I know I had, again, I only had a half day of work, and I could have gone and played golf, for instance. Or gone out, you know, doing something, just enjoying, get out, recreating this incredible, amazing weather we're having. And I said, no, you know what? You know, it's time, I got to press forward on this. 17th is coming up soon. Gotta keep grinding away at this, and that's what I'm doing. It's just like early, you know, mid-afternoon now. And this shows, you know, what you have to do on the spiritual path is you cannot be a slacker. You absolutely cannot. So obviously you don't want to hang around other slackers. And I've had a problem with that actually, and you just don't like it. Because you know that's failure. You know, because of the continuity problem is failure. The problem with slackers is they do not account for the continuity problem. And the ego lies to them. The ego tells them, you're smart enough, you know, at some point you'll be smart enough, you just get it just like that. Why are you doing all these, you know, every day working so hard? You don't need to work hard. You should be able to get it. If truth is true, you should be able to get it like that. And so these people believe that, and they spend their whole life being slackers, and they don't get it. And of course they claim that after they're dead, they get it. Of course anyone can say that. You know, show me the proof. Here. Oh, you know, anyone can say, well, after I die, I'm going to go to paradise. You know, those in this world, how can we confirm that? So, you know, get it now. So if you hang around slackers, you're going to turn into a slacker too. Pretty much, or it's going to be difficult for you. It's very difficult for you. And of course, we're all afraid to hang around non-slackers because we're afraid it's too much work. It's too much work. So, you know, who wants to be locked up in a monastery, getting up at 4:30 every morning and doing, you know, 10 hours of prayer every day or something, and then manual labor in your whole life? Not many people would choose that. It would certainly be helpful. It would certainly be helpful. It's not a given, because it depends on the prayer, the emphasis, etc. Bottom line is, don't hang around slackers. And if there are slackers that you're in your life, try to stay away from them as much as possible, actually. Don't entertain them, because they will call you to slacking. Inevitably, slackers want to justify their slacking. They'll claim, oh, I'm not slacking. No. I'm actually making great progress towards the truth. Why? Because they're trusting the ego. And they think the ego has the truth for them. So they think that the more they gain the trust of the ego, the more the ego's told them, the closer they get to the ego sharing its secret with them. Okay, so what is the ego's secret again? The ego's secret is that it believes it can convince you to annihilate yourself. That's a secret. So the more we trust in the ego, we do get closer to its secret. That is true. Except its secret doesn't work. Its secret leaves us in this state of total mental chaos. And then the Holy Spirit has to pick up the pieces, which is, that's its job. So of course it does do that. Wonderfully does do that, gradually. It's not an easy overnight thing to pick up the pieces of, you know, this total chaos and then changing and switching advisors and realizing that, you know, your advisor you followed for so long really was just trying to convince you to destroy yourself. That's its secret advice that the trust in the ego had brought you. So these people, slackers, are trusting in the ego. That's where they're headed. That's unfortunately where they're headed. And it may not seem that for a long time. It doesn't seem that way. I mean, my life previous to this, when I was super successful, I was like some great personality, because the built up trust in the personality to such an extent, you know, that it was just, the personality was just this bigger than life personality. And then this life, you know, I tried to basically, what happened was I recognized in the afterlife condition, I was able to get some clarity about the whole situation. But then I thought I could use my bigger than life personality to impress this upon the world and was not aware of the continuity problem. You see, and then I ran into the continuity problem, and I tried to overcome the personality. It didn't work. And so I tried to strengthen my personality and trust in, which means trust in the ego ultimately. And then that brought about the collapse into mental chaos. That's what happens. But once you account for the continuity problem, that's not going to happen to you anymore. But you have to make that central. That's the central teaching, is the continuity problem. Otherwise, you won't succeed. You won't get anywhere. You won't accept that truth is exclusive to truth. It's not part truth and part lies. Because we're so used to the idea that this delaying tactic of mutual exclusives, which the ego is telling us there's a way, that we have such a hard time realizing that truth, only truth is true. There's only one truth, not two. Continuity problem comes up and knocks us off course. This cat is the ultimate slacker here. The cat just likes to hang out. Very much the slacker. Sleeping his life away. We cannot be like the cat, sleeping our life away. We cannot. Bump this up. Have to keep moving your comfort zone every day. It's like you're on a pilgrimage. Really, the path is like a pilgrimage. Yeah, there's no place really to stop along the road. You every night you stop along the road and you lie down on some mat or something on the road, and then in the morning you get up and you're nowhere. You're still on the road. And there's nowhere to really stop at all. You know, you realize there's nowhere I'm happy to stop here. I've got to keep on going. And so you say, hey, the sooner I get to the end of this road, the better. Because there's nowhere to stop on this road. There's always rocks underneath. When I'm trying to sleep or rest, there's just rocks everywhere. Yeah, I just can't be a slacker. Cannot be a slacker. So one thing I could say about my life is I was not a slacker. I, you know, probably could have done even a little bit more. Every day I feel like I should be doing more, should be doing better. But that sometimes that is also a trick by the ego, which tries to get you to quit by making you feel that you're not trying hard enough. So there's something wrong with you and you're not really cut out for it. That's a trick too. So the real way is to make sure that you put in a really strong effort every day. But don't fall for the ego when it says, well, you put in 14 hours, you should have put it in 20, you know, and that kind of thing. That will trip you up also. So even in your intense effort of non-slacking every day, have a balance of moderation there too. Want to go at it, you know, just ferociously 24 hours a day for 3 years in a row, whatever, I'm going to just push through. Well, that doesn't necessarily work, because the continuity problem is such that you need to give yourself some time to settle into the new, your new understanding. And you may go at it for 3 years like that and then take 3 years off thinking like, wow, that's like the rabbit that makes a mighty leap and then suddenly it leaps back in the direction it came from, another mighty leap. The tortoise is the one that succeeds. The tortoise is the one that every day it actually covers quite a bit of distance. Rough, rocky terrain. The tortoise goes through very tough terrain. And it actually, you know, the tortoise moves slow, but it just relentlessly, it makes progress. And then it sleeps for a while, and maybe it'll rest or stop for a little while and rest and then keep going. The hare takes these mighty leaps. So if you just make a decent amount of progress every day, just keep going. Say, you know, I went a long distance today, another long distance, and it's really good progress, but I didn't do something like completely amazing today, and not every day necessarily. Some days it'll feel that way. That's what you have to do, and then you don't quit. That way, you can do it every day, every single day without fail, which I don't know, last time I have taken a day off, I really could not even remotely remember if there ever has been a day I've taken off and just, I have no idea. It's been, you know, maybe it's been that whole time, 44 years, or actually for me it would be, 44 years, or actually 46, but 44, you can say that, whatever, mid-40s. I don't believe I have taken a day off. Some days might have been a little bit, you know, margin to some extent, but always there's a feeling like I got to figure something, I got to get it today. What, you know, just didn't just completely forget about it. No, I don't think so. If you see those people who, you know, the yogis or those who I seem to have be far along the path or whatever. Well, what you're really looking at is simply the people who never took a day off. That's what you're looking at. That's what you're looking at. They're at it every day. And of course we say in our crazy world that we're in now, how could anyone do that? Well, I've managed to do it. And you can do it. You absolutely can do it. Now, what suffers is your personality, as far as building up a great big personality, a great persona, that does take suffer. That dwindles, because you can't do both, really. You cannot do both. So your superstar status, as far as personality goes, that diminishes, it definitely does. So don't place stock on these personality superstars. Believe me, they're slackers. They're slackers. And of course, people who want to be slackers love other slackers to justify their position. They say misery loves company. Well, slackers love company even more. You know, there's nothing like a community of slackers. And they say, look, everybody is like this. So I'm just one of the crowd. I'm normal. Slacking is normal. You know, the dream of this world that the ego wants is to have a world full of slackers. That's really what it wants. And it wants everybody to look around and say, my God, everybody's just like me. This is totally normal. This is there. If it's totally normal, it must be God-given. God must have created it this way. That's what the ego wants. That's why I say these times it's a crisis. I say World War III has broken out already. And it's a crisis, an ideological crisis of attempting to turn this world into 100% slackers on this planet without any exception, wants to get rid of everybody who is actually working on it. Now, the world may get its way. They may have all slackers here, because those who are not slackers may go somewhere else, actually, because they don't want to be pressured that much. When you really realize the importance of the spiritual path, you don't want to get knocked out. You don't suffer fools gladly. You don't want to be around slackers. You don't. No way. No way. Because you know how tough it is, how tough the continuity problem is, how much you're suffering, how the ego really wants to destroy you. And if you don't get free of the ego, you will continue down that wretched path. So it's a super serious thing, very serious. You don't want to hang around slackers. You don't want to give them the time of day. So if the goal of the world is to turn the entire world into slackers, you don't want to be a part of such a situation. No way. No way. That sun is starting to hit me. Over here, it's wherever I go. I have to kick the cat off. I go over here. Let's see if I can do that. Yeah, well, still hitting. Oh, well. Oh, well, that's fine. It's just that time of day, right? You can't change the position of the sun in the sky. It's that time of day. And in this world, it's the time of day where slacking, spiritual slacking, has become the new religion on the planet. The new religion. And those who don't slack, the non-slackers, are being demonized as lunatics. They're being demonized. They're saying, these people are nutcases. What are they doing? They're making me feel abnormal. I feel uncomfortable when I feel abnormal. I feel I'm being bullied when I feel uncomfortable. I feel I'm being targeted. I feel this is a hate crime. I feel this is, you know, I feel. The ego's teaching this whole chain of so-called reaction to non-slackers, teaching slacking in the world. The curriculum of this planet, in the schools, everywhere, is slacking. Spiritual slacking is the curriculum. And the people are being taught how to bully and repress non-slackers. And it's a whole chain of things, like, well, wait a minute, you know, I don't feel comfortable because you're making me feel like maybe I'm not normal. You think I'm, you know, the slackers are saying this to the non-slackers. You're making me feel uncomfortable. I feel like I'm not, you know, and you're not allowing me to lead. I want to lead you in slacking, you know, because the non-slackers say, no, I don't want you to lead if what you're leading me is in slacking. And then the slackers say, oh, you don't want me to lead. You're bullying me. You see, you're trying to keep me from leading. You're trying to suppress me. I don't feel comfortable. I feel upset by this. It's causing my life to be unacceptable. I'm unhappy. You know, all this stuff. And then eventually they get, well, it's a hate crime. You're trying to demean me by your attitude is demeaning me because you're not accepting my slacking. You're making me feel that my identity, myself, is unacceptable to me, and this is hurtful to me. And, you know, all this stuff that the younger generations have been indoctrinated into. It's just a complete psych job to try and bully the non-slackers in this world. That's absolutely what it is. So being a non-slacker myself, I am adamantly supportive of non-slackers. That's why I say the stuff that I say. Because I know how tough it is. And it's brutal in this world. It's brutal. But it's a job that has to be done. So all non-slackingness to everyone here. And be aware that there are these massive tidal forces at play in this world to target non-slacking as if it were some kind of the worst crime possible, that it makes others feel abnormal and is therefore an attack upon others, that it's some kind of prejudice or intolerance towards others. They're not tolerating their slacking. Like, if you don't tolerate their slacking, well, of course we don't tolerate it, because we tolerate it, but we don't want to be around it. And they say, well, that's prejudice. You know, what they're going to say is, in every workplace, you must have a ratio of 9 slackers to 1 non-slacker, that kind of thing. It'll become a quota system, actually. It already tacitly is a quota system in a lot of ways. And those groups of people which are notorious slackers, the ego loves slackers, the ego is trying to make them into something like the figureheads, the role models of the planet. The ego wants the notorious slackers to be role models for everybody else on the planet. And any criticism of that is a crime. Should be a crime. The ego believes it should be a crime, literally. And it's trying to adjust all the laws to, you know, to get there. To get there. That it should be a crime to not follow the lead of the slackers. To criticize, or not to want to hang around them even. It's a crime to not want to be with them. To seek their advice and follow their advice is a crime. In fact, the ego says that's the worst crime of all. Worse than murder, worse than anything, is to not embrace the slackers. Because that's the ego's only hope, is that we keep embracing slacking in our lives. Because if we don't, if we become non-slackers, we will eventually align our valuing with the vision of oneness, and then we realize that we're free of the ego. You know, we're free of this ego's crazy misdirection. So, of course, the ego's goal is to make it, you know, the most serious crime possible to not embrace slackers in your life. You must do everything possible to be a slacker. You must be diverted by constant nuisances, by constant petty demands, constant daily routines that sap your time and energy and focus. You must be diverted in every possible way in order to not fall afoul of these new laws that the ego is pushing on the planet. This is what's called spiritual darkness. When you have a planet that's dedicated to spiritual slacking, you have a situation of extreme spiritual darkness here. And that's where we're at. That's where we're at. So, of course, the whole non-slacking movement is appraising all of this and what its options are. It doesn't seem like there's a whole lot of non-slackers on this planet, but there are some, and there are some here and there. There are some those who follow the ego's plan very assiduously, and they think they're not slacking, but they are. They are. Absolutely they are. They cannot bring their spiritual will to bear, you know, on the vision of oneness. They cannot value it. They cannot see what is interfering with it. They cannot accept. They have a severe continuity problem that's interfering with their acceptance of it. They're simply being very religiously dedicated to the ego's plan. The ego's plan. And again, simply a mistake to be recognized and lovingly corrected by the Holy Spirit. So, the Holy Spirit's pointed out to me that there's this essentially, World War III has broken out. It has, which is a war against non-slackers, essentially, okay? It is a war against non-slackers. Don't doubt that for a second. It is. And said, I was told I have to be ready by March 17th for something. Okay. Getting ready here. Getting ready. Maybe some option will present itself. I don't know. I don't know. I'm not worried about that. I'm just focused on continuing to make progress, pushing things through, and this weather's not making anything easier. But actually, yeah, I can tape at night because it's so warm. So it's okay. It's okay. Even when I was like driving around California and doing all this stuff, I was still constantly doing spiritual practice as I was driving. So there's a focus, there's an intense focus of whatever I was doing. I was trying to use it as a spiritual practice. Even when I go golf, you know, it's the same way. I try to use it in that way. But it's not ideal. I think it's better to sit quietly somewhere and focus in for several hours. That's a better plan, actually. But then you tend to get out of shape, which isn't the best thing. So when you exercise, incorporate spiritual practice in your exercise, some way, whatever you're doing. The vision of oneness, only the vision of oneness has value. The ego's plan has no value whatsoever. Only the Holy Spirit's plan of salvation has value. Self-annihilation has zero value. The vision of oneness has total value. You know, you have to, whatever you're doing, you have to find a way the will to remind yourself. And if you can't do it, if you find sitting quietly is the best way, then sit quietly like this. Just sit quietly and focus in. I think it is the best way, my experience. The more active you are, the harder it is to concentrate. So, you know, really physically active stuff, it's like you're playing basketball. It's very difficult. Golf's a little easier because you're just very passive most of the time. A lot of quiet time, a lot of downtime. But still, I would say sitting quietly is the best. So what did the cat do when I moved over? It went to another place right in front here of the camera, and it's lying in the sun there. So of course the cat may not be a symbol of slacking. It could be non-slacking. It may be spending all of its time, if we think it's sleeping, it's actually focusing in. It could be a symbol of that. And quiet sitting could be a symbol of quiet sitting. I try to take it that way. Cat's a good example of quiet sitting. It knows how to spend large amounts of time sitting quietly. Interesting. I've always had cats. I used to have dogs, but I found dogs caused me to lose my focus. Their obsession with you and everything is very bad. I love dogs, but I find for spiritual practice, very bad. Not good at all. Cats, I like cats because they're simply their extreme capacity to sit in one place all day without, you know, breaking their focus all day. Very impersonal. You know, those are actually spiritual qualities as far as practicing go. Very nice qualities. I think, hey, if the cat can sit here for a couple hours, I can sit here too. Whereas the dog, you know, the dog said, hey, take me for a walk. I want to go smell everything. Whoops, I want to go say hello to that person. Oh, I want to be moving around. Oh, you're neglecting me. Oh, my gosh. And you see in the world now, people, slackers, are more and more getting dogs. There's a dog mania in the world because they're a great distraction and diversion, really. Because if you don't feel so guilty when you're paying attention to a dog. You say, well, the dog wants my attention. Cat usually doesn't ask for much attention, to tell you the truth. The cat just says, leave me alone, I'm happy. I'm just sitting here in the sun, I'm very happy. No guilt trip being laid on you. But at least where I live, I think it's all around many places in the U.S. at least, and is a dog mania. You know, they have all these stickers there, trust in dog, you know, trust in dog. Because it means trust in slacking, trust in the ego, trust in being diversion from spiritual practice, from non-slacking, trust in that. That's what trust in dog really means, trust in dog. It's a reversal of God. And you know, dogs, you don't feel too bad about slacking. You say, well, I gotta take care of this dog, and the dog of be upset if I don't, you know, so. And we think our children are a great distraction too, but we think that children want us to be all busy, but really we use children as distraction devices, to tell you the truth. That's what adults do. The truth is, this may hurt, but no, we're looking at stuff carefully here. Is that most parents, the reason why they have children is for the purpose of distraction. And they love the antics of the children. It's very distracting for them. They feel like, this is a pleasant way to spend time. I don't have to be focusing on changing my valuing towards the vision of oneness. That's okay. This God wants me to be focused on the children like this. And what I found is I hated that. Absolutely resented and hated it. I didn't want to be used as a distraction device for adults. I was serious. Very serious. I wanted to be taken seriously. I wanted to be able to quiet time. I wanted focused time, intelligent conversation with ideas and stuff. As a child, of course. intelligent children want to be taken seriously. They don't want to be just a distraction device of antics, of dressing up in funny clothes and saying funny things. Parents, it's like the dog. I mean, basically, most parents look at their children as like dogs, tell you the truth. You know, real cute dog. Say over here, oh, you're so cute, you know. And the children are like, ah, what is this? What the hell is going on here? Well, you know, this is like, ah. I just say, what the heck is going on? What the HE double toothpicks is going on here, you know? And don't like it at all. A lot of children can't. I couldn't stand that. I absolutely couldn't stand it. I'm not a dog. I'm not a distraction device. But that is what parents want. To a large extent, they want an excuse. Children are excuses. But, you know, and they insist that the children would be malformed, psychologically damaged if they don't look at them that way. That's not true at all. It's just the opposite. They're damaged because they are turned into these objects of diversion objects, distraction objects. That's what causes the problem. But if you show your children your seriousness about the pilgrim's path, your seriousness about being a non-slacker, you're really getting after it. Children will look at that and say, wow, I like that. I like that. That's a great example. That helps me out. That helps me out. This is a good example. That I want to get this habit in my life. I want to get this habit in my life. That's what they really appreciate and want. They want some discipline. They want to say, hey, you know, you're not just a distraction object. Hey, you know, put in your time. Start putting in your time now. Start putting in your time now. Children can start early on the spiritual path. Absolutely they do. There's some schools and some ashrams, various religious places around the world have schools for children that get them started in hopefully towards a vision of oneness. It's that has slacked off a great deal over time in modern times. Because up until about 12, children do have this appreciation of oneness. They kind of have not had the personality, hasn't quite got sunken its fangs into them so severely. But once it does, then the problems, then there are severe problems for sure. So we're looking at all the taboos here, and the idea that the parents have children for some wonderful reason is not true. They use it to strengthen their own personalities, is what they really have children for, is to strengthen their own commitment to the personality, which means being a slacker. Personality is a slacker. That's it. It's doing what the ego wants it to do, which is to not do right spiritual exercise, not confess severe continuity problem, not work on the continuity problem. To be a spiritual slacker, that's what the personality is all about. And we have children, because we feel that they're going to help us help the personality be a slacker, more of a slacker. That's why. That's why we have children. And it takes a lot of maturity for parents to realize that and realize, wait a minute, you know, maybe there's something going on here more than just this fanciful rationalization that I'm giving, like, I'm having children because God wants me to have children, something like that, and I'm doing my debt to God. Well, the debt to God is really, in this world, is really the debt to the ego, and the ego wants you to have children to be distracted. Now, it's possible to have children and not be distracted, too, if you're really honest. But most people realize that having children is going to be quite a distraction, especially in this modern age, where basically if you do not teach your children the false egoic religion of distraction and slackerness, you are socially damaging your child, and the children will be removed from your custody. And you find out that Who is really in charge of your children? The state is in charge of your children. They're just saying, you do the job that we want you to do, or else we'll do it for you. That's what's really going on in this world. bird just landed somewhere. That's what's going on. So if you really raise your children correctly, the state will step in and say, hey, you're not doing what we want you to do. You're an incompetent parent. So the parents are under this insane pressure right now. Totally insane pressure. A lot of parents are trying to homeschool their children, but still the pressure is just becoming more and more and more. If you don't give them all the shots, the cat's moving this a little bit, but they need, that the state tells you, you gotta give them all these shots. You gotta give them this right kind of nutrition. The state is basically going to dictate to the parents how they have to raise their children. And the children are really wards of the state being loaned out to the parents to do the state's work for them. That's how it is now. And when you have a situation where one parent is a slacker and the other is a non-slacker, and now the slacker can easily make a complaint to the state and threaten the other parent that the children are going to be removed from the family if they don't go along with the slacking program. Or they can bring up charges against the non-slacker as being an incompetent parent and force them to leave and not be able to see the children. All this brutal stuff around children and families now has been taking place for the last 44 years. A lot of incredible brutality has taken place over the last 44.4 years. A ton of it. I've seen it all. Unbelievable stuff. And now it's just all accepted as commonplace, normal. And the next step will be taken. So why did that what's that airplane vanishing thing about? Malaysian airline vanishing? Answer is, it doesn't matter, does it? Because we've just spent all this time here talking about something way more important than why the air people vanished. But it could be a foreshadowing of the vanishing of a whole lot more people. It could be. If you want to look at it that way, is it possible that because of this massive crackdown on non-slackers, the non-slackers may find themselves in some other dimension, vanish? That is very possible, actually. It won't even need a plane to get there. There may be this just dimensional, we're told in the blink of an eye, actually. It could be in the blink of an eye, we simply find ourselves in another dimension in some way, shape, or form. I'm not sure how it works. But again, we've spent our time in a better way than ruminating over, what happened to this plane, what happened to this plane, what happened to this plane, even though it's fun to think about it. That's slacking. You don't want to be slacking too much, okay? All right. Very great. We've really gone at it great, right?